and his disciples, Jesus and his disciples, and a large crowd were leaving Jericho. Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stood still and said, "Call him here." "Take heart, get up, he's calling you," said the others. So throwing off his cloak, he sprang up and came to Jesus. And then Jesus said to him, "What do you want me to do for you?" The blind man said to him, "My teacher, let me see again." Jesus said to him, "Go, your faith has made you well." And immediately he regained his sight and followed him on the way. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So chapter 10 of Mark, as we've talked about last, we've been in chapter 10 for 3 weeks now. And we talked about how chapter 10 is a turning point in the Gospel of Mark. Before it was healing and teaching. Did I forget to do the offering?
Yes.
Oh my goodness, how did I do that? Let's do it after the sermon. Thank you. Thanks for watching out for us, though. Thank you. So it's a turning point. Up to this point, everything was like teaching and healing, and then they reached a point where Jesus said, the Son of Man has to go to Jerusalem, and he will die there. That was chapter 10. That's where the turning point, and everything after chapter 10 in the gospel is Jesus on the way to Jerusalem. Jesus on the way. And as he's leaving Jericho to go up to Jerusalem, which is quite a hike, 3,000 feet up from Jericho to Jerusalem. Jericho is 800 feet below sea level. Jerusalem is over 2,000 feet above sea level. So can you imagine going up this? It's like a 20-mile hike up a hill like this. So this is where they're headed. Leaving Jericho, there is this man, and he's named Bartimaeus, and he starts crying out for Jesus. Wherever Jesus went, there was a commotion. All through the crowds, there was a commotion. And people along the streets, they lined the street to see what he looks like and to maybe hear a message. Sometimes they would climb trees so they could hear him better. Sometimes they would reach out and touch his garment, hoping to get a blessing. This is the life of Jesus and his disciples, wherever they went. And so it was in this crowd, in this commotion, all this going on, and Bartimaeus starts crying out for Jesus. What do the people do around him? They shush him. Have you ever been shushed? Anybody here not been shushed? Yes, indeed. Babies sometimes are shushed. So it doesn't feel good to be shushed. And Bartimaeus saw this is his one opportunity to connect with somebody who could help him, the Son of David. Son of David is a messianic title. It's more than just saying you're somebody's son. It's saying that you're God's chosen, the one sent to save us. You're a special one. Trust, even the title is a sign of trust. Oftentimes, the Bible speaks of blind Bartimaeus. This is how he's been known throughout history, blind Bartimaeus. That's another affront. It's not fun to be defined by one characteristic of your being. There's more to Bartimaeus than that he's a blind person. There's a human being there. But people throughout history have just defined him by his inability to see and the fact that he was healed. his inability to see, but the fact that he was healed. In chapter 10, several times, beginning with the rich young man, beginning with the children coming to ask for, surrounding Jesus, and the disciples said, send those children away. And Jesus said, no, let the children come unto me. Jesus wanted the children there, and he corrected the disciples. And then next we have this rich young man come to Jesus and asking, what must I do to be saved? And Jesus again takes the side of it's humility. It's humility. Salvation comes in humbling yourself. It doesn't come in glorifying yourself. And then the disciples come, James and John, and they're saying, what must we want you to do something for us. We want to sit on your left hand and your right hand. And again, Jesus takes the side of the lowly position, saying, if you want to come after me, you must humble yourself, become a servant. And then he gives an example of washing people's feet like a servant person. This is Jesus. So over and over, Jesus is taking the side of the oppressed over the powerful, calling people to humility over glorifying yourself. So again, in this story, one more time, there's this poor, humble beggar crying out for help, and the privileged people, all of whom who have all their faculties and can see perfectly, all start shushing him. So again, Jesus takes the side of the beggar over the powerful. Each of these situations, he's given us an example of what his ministry is about, giving victory to people who are the oppressed, and challenging people who are their oppressors. And the oppressors are saying, shh, 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 don't bother him, don't bother him. Like they're watching out for Jesus, right? Like they're watching out for Jesus. And Jesus says, let him come, let him come. And invites Bartimaeus, and Bartimaeus springs up and rushes to Jesus as fast as he can. And Jesus then says, What do you want me to do for you? He doesn't presume. I mean, it's pretty clear the guy can't see. You would assume he would just say, let me heal you. Instead, he gives him agency, as we say, agency to say what he needs and to ask for help. Jesus, that's a sign of respect, a sign of giving him the chance to say exactly before all these people, I need help, let me see. I need help, let me see. So Jesus shows some compassion to him. This past week, I was headed over here, a different route, and I noticed a sign to the suffragist monument for the women who were held prison here at Lorton Prison, because all they wanted was what? To have the right to vote. To have the right to vote. In our day, it's hard to even think that for so long in our country, women were not even allowed to vote. 140 years. Longer than our country has existed, women were not allowed to vote. Finally, in 1920, they passed the amendment to allow women the right to vote. But it took a long time, and it took women who were persistent and insisted that this is a human right. It's not just for men. Throughout our history, we've had an expanding of the democracy. The original Constitution, even though it said in the Declaration of Independence, all men are created equal. And people always say, well, men means men and women are all created equal. But they weren't treated equal. When they wrote the Constitution, only men with property were allowed to vote. And later on, they said, okay, other white men can vote. And then with the Civil War, we said African-American men can vote, but they didn't allow the women to vote. It was, how long? 60 years. from the end of the Civil War until 1920, before the country decided women should vote too. And it was because the women shouted out, like Bartimaeus, they refused to be silenced. These women who went to the prison at Wharton refused to be silenced. They set up their protests down at the White House in front of President Wilson, where he couldn't come outside without these women shouting at him and waving their signs at him, demanding the right to vote. The women refused to be silenced. And don't you know there are a lot of men who are saying, shh, 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 shh. It's not the time. It's not the time. Not only did they shush them, they arrested them. And they put them in prison here. Wharton Prison, right across the street, right through there. How far? A mile from here. And the women still would not be silent. Even though nobody was listening, they refused to eat. You might not listen to us, but we're not going to go quietly. They refused to eat. They went on a hunger strike. And what did the men do? They force-fed them. They put tubes down their throats and force-fed them so they wouldn't die in prison and be an embarrassment to the establishment. There were people in power and people oppressed. And I got to believe God was on the side of the oppressed women. I got to believe God was on the side of the oppressed. Over and over, God cares for those who are being put down, and God lifts them up. Over and over. So we have an election coming. I'm very careful not to be political in the pulpit. I try to stick to the scriptures. The scripture can be pretty direct, though, about liberation and lifting up the oppressed. But I don't take sides politically. I do side for democracy, and I hope you all vote. Take advantage of the privilege you have. Let your voice be heard. Not voting is opting out of the system. If you can find some way to participate, the women work so hard, especially women. Our whole country has struggled with this to the point today where everybody over, is it 18? It is 18, right? Everybody over 18 can vote, regardless of your status, regardless of your gender, regardless of who you are. You can participate in this democracy. Amen.
Amen.
And pray for our country in this time. We gotta pray for our country in this time. So let's do our offering now. Thank you, Breshna. And we'll stand and sing the doxology, and then we'll have our closing. Please stand. Privilege and honor of being able to support your work with our money and our gifts. We pray that you use these gifts, multiply them out, be a blessing to our church, our community, and our world. We ask it in Christ's name.
Amen. Amen.
Let's remain standing. We're going to sing Here I Am. It's on page 593. Thank you. Glad you're here today, especially our guests. We have 5 guests today. I think that's outstanding. And I know there are other people out in this community looking for a place of belonging, and we pray for them as well. Receive now God's blessing. Oh God, we thank you that you are with us. We thank you, God, for all the ways you've blessed lives like Bartimaeus and how you've blessed us as well, how you have opened our eyes to see you more clearly and to love you more dearly and to follow you more nearly, amen, day by day. Amen.
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 God bless.
It's not nice to
you're so brave.
Did you finally settle in your place? Everything okay? Took care of the old house. Now you have to. Do I hang it here or do I hang it here? It would look better over there.
Yes. Hola, nice to see you.
He was quiet today. He was quiet today.
Thank you, baby. Peanut butter.